Side note, Norris Bradbury, group leader for Bomb Assembly, later became the director of Los Alamos after the departure of Oppenheimer. He was responsible for many contributions to the facility. Historically, at 5:30 a.m. on July 16, 1945, Los Alamos scientists detonated a plutonium bomb at a test site located in the U.S. Air Force Base at Alamogordo, New Mexico, some 120 miles south of Albuquerque. Oppenheimer chose the name Trinity for the test site, inspired by the poetry of John Donne. The test had been scheduled for 4 a.m., but when the time came, it was raining, and the appointed hour was pushed back to 5:30. Tensions ran high at the test site, where those assembled included the scientist Enrico Fermi, who had directed the first nuclear chain reaction in December 1942, U.S. Army Brigadier General Leslie Groves, Bush, Oppenheimer, and others. Another historical reference, a press release written to explain the blast. It made the papers in New Mexico, but was ignored by U.S. Eastern news agencies. Several releases were prepared, pending the outcome of the blast and the severity of its impact. Essentially, it was all misinformation, but considering the importance of secrecy to national security, at this point, forgivable. Here is the actual historic press release. Alamogordo, New Mexico, July 16. The commanding officer of the Alamogordo Army Air Force Base made the following statement today. Several inquiries have been received concerning a heavy explosion which occurred on the Alamogordo Air Base reservation this morning. A remotely located ammunition magazine containing a considerable amount of high explosives and pyrotechnics exploded. There was no loss of life or injury to anyone, and the property damage outside of the explosive magazine was negligible. Weather conditions affecting the content of gas shells exploded by the blast may make it desirable for the Army to evacuate temporarily a few civilians from their homes. End of press release. 34. 1100 hours, January 7, 1945. Nuremberg Penitentiary for Prisoners of the State. "Orderly!" shouted Captain Fisher Rowe. Events of the day were quickly intensifying his indignation. Some of the children looked back in alarm and fear, breaking their death march. The orderly poked his head into the room, and Fisher Rowe continued, "I want to retain some of these children for questioning. Certain youths have been engaged in cooperating with the underground in sabotage incidents. They will have to remain here until the office of the commandant can send someone to question them. While we are waiting for his arrival, my aide and I will speak with this man." He pointed to Bonhoeffer. The orderly said, "You can speak with him in his cell." Fisher Rowe knew he had the advantage. "You can check with the warden. We agreed to speak with him here in this room. Now, you may wait outside." "This man is a prisoner. It's my responsibility to..." More forcefully, Captain Fisher Rowe reiterated, "We will keep the prisoner in line. My aide and I are armed." Peter drew his pistol, pointed it at the prisoner. Back to the orderly, Werner repeated, "You are excused." The orderly responded with a sarcastic, "Which ones do we keep? The trucks are waiting outside." "All of them," barked the captain. "The transports can wait. I want all of the children left just here, waiting against that wall." He gestured to the far corner of the room. "I will speak to them alone, as there may be state secrets. Now leave us." "Yes, Herr Captain," smirked the orderly, and he turned and left the room, signaling the guards to go with him. They had the children seat themselves quietly against the wall. Peter did a quick check of the doors leading into the room and confirmed that they were alone. Fisher Rowe turned to Bonhoeffer, who was sitting, quietly amused. The clergyman had taken in the scene and looked at the captain expectantly. "Do you know who I am?" asked the regional minister of propaganda. "A man of importance, a man of vision," Bonhoeffer intoned. "Did you know it was I who had you imprisoned?" I was under the impression that it was my papers against the state that caused that. "Do you know that I could have you executed in an instant?" the captain continued. "And yet, you would save the lives of vagabond, unimportant children." Bonhoeffer gestured to them. Fischer Roe was impressed that Bonhoeffer was not intimidated. He pulled a chair over and sat next to the priest. Peter stood between them, wary. "Put away your Luger, Peter." Bonhoeffer observed the energy between them. It was an observation without judgment, Fischer Roe noted. He said to Peter, "Call for Marie. Bring her here." Peter reholstered the weapon and called to the children, "Get Marie." The child next to Marie tugged on her shirt and pointed. Marie got up and ran over, smiling, to Peter, who picked her up and hugged her. She kissed him on the cheek. Now they had Bonhoeffer's attention. "A deaf Jew child?" he challenged. "We have grown quite fond of her," Fischer Roe said quietly. "Really, a handicapped, dark-haired orphan, especially now in the final gasps of Hitler's Aryan army. Her life is worth nothing to them. This is a far reach for an officer minister of the Third Reich." His countenance softened. "Captain, how did this unique situation come to be?" "Unique, yes, I concur, and that is a long story, but now it seems that I need to engage you, my former enemy, to help us carry out a rescue." Peter looked at Bonhoeffer, then back to his partner, with a raise of the eyebrow. Bonhoeffer stared straight back at the captain. "At your service, sir." In minutes, Fischer Roe outlined a plan that would involve Bonhoeffer, Peter, and himself. It would call for daring and split-second timing. "This afternoon I am due to address the striking workers of the Nuremberg Industrial Plant No. 2. I have been ordered to either force their cooperation or send them to the work camps. There are 450 workers in this plant, and I must say that, due to my attachment to Marie and these other children, I no longer have the heart to do either. I still plan to speak, but after my speech I will certainly be a target for the wrath of the Gestapo. Actually, my life will not be, in the words of my American parrot, worth a plug nickel." Peter stood, nodding a confirmation. "Now, here are the details," the captain continued. He drilled them in their tasks for another 20 minutes until each man was sure of his part. When he finished, he asked, "Will you do it, Father Bonhoeffer?" "I am only too happy to help children, but how do you know I will cooperate?" The captain answered, "I have read each of your papers, respectably researched and annotated, and I am familiar with most of your books. You are an honorable man, and your sincerity cannot be questioned. It is just that your principles are at odds with those of the Third Reich." Bonhoeffer smiled. "And now, it seems, Captain, so are yours." "So it seems," Fischer Roe said.